Welcome back to our session of microeconomics. Today we are going to continue with the imperfect competition. So far we have learned what is monopoly, how does a monopoly firm maximize its profit, and today we are going to have a complete comparison of what a monopoly firm at the extreme and perfect competition firm at the extreme have as a differentiation in their operations, right? So two spectrum we will see. First is your monopoly and another is your perfect competition. Now here we will be talking about a single firm, because in monopoly we know that there is only one single seller, that is a single firm. So the level of operations in case of monopoly is that the demand of products in a market is the entire market demand of the single firm only, because he is the only seller in the available market. So he is a single seller. But in perfect competition, it is not the case. In perfect competition, we know that there are absolutely no barriers to entry and exit. So in perfect competition, the number of buyers and sellers is so large that none of them can influence the market demand or market supply. They just exist when there is a profit-making situation, and they will leave the market when there is normal profit, that is economic profits are zero, or there are negative profits. So they will not be interested, they will leave, that is exit, and they will come, exist, entry when there are profit making situations, means the economic profits are positive. So having said that there is a single seller, what type of products do you think a monopolist sells? A monopolist is the only seller available in the market, so he will not try to develop products which are substitutes of each other. Because if that becomes the case, if the monopolist develops products which are substitutes of each other, the product with lower price will be demanded in the market and the other product will not be demanded as much. So what is happening that the monopolist himself is cutting the branch on which he is sitting. Means he is trying to create a situation where he himself is rendering losses to him. Correct? So he will not want the production of such two products which are close substitutes of each other, or let's say substitutes of any degree for each other. So all the products that he makes are what? Differentiated. No close substitutes of each other. Every product will be different and it will demand a different price based on its nature and use. But on the other hand, what happens in perfect competition, that this, like I told you in the very start, very beginning, that perfect competition is the idealistic form. It is the most ideal form which might or might not be practically seen in the market systems, but many firms come very close to it. So in perfect competition, we see that all the large number of sellers that sell or operate in the market produce similar goods, means the goods are what? Homogeneous. Homogeneous products. The goods are homogeneous means they are identical in shape, size, quantity, all of these things. Now, because they are homogeneous, you can also say that they are perfect substitutes of each other. Now, when I say perfect substitute, immediately you think what is going to be the price elasticity? And when I say differentiated product, what is going to be the price elasticity? See, in monopoly, what happens is there is only a single seller. Even if he increases or decreases prices, you do not have much of an option to, you know, lay off the demand or demand more and more, because you know this is the single seller, all the products as and when you required will be available. And also on the other hand, whatever prices this monopolist sets, that prices you have to agree upon. So here the elasticity is what? Less than one. The demand curve is what? Steeper. Correct? But in this case, I am telling you that the products are homogeneous. They are absolutely perfect substitutes of each other. Means here the elasticity is going to be infinite. You can change the consumption pattern from one good to another without losing anything. Like I told you in elasticity chapter, that higher the degree of elasticity means the substitutes are more. The more the substitutes, the higher is the degree of elasticity. And what higher degree than infinite? So your demand curve is what? Horizontal and parallel to x-axis, and your elasticity is what? Infinite. Okay, and here your elasticity is less than 1. Elasticity is infinite. Correct? So this is also how you can remember how a monopolist demand curve operates. The demand curve is inelastic, so it will be steeper, and here the demand curve is horizontal and parallel to x-axis. Moving forward, what happens in case of price taking and price making behavior? Since you are the only person controlling the market, since there is a one man show, he can make the prices because he is the only seller putting barriers all across the market that nobody can enter. So if you are the monopolist, if you are providing a certain service or you are selling certain goods, what happens is you are the only one who can make the prices. So monopolist himself is the price maker. He can decide at what prices to sell which goods. Obviously, he has n number of differentiated products, and every product's prices are set by the monopolist himself. Obviously, he takes into consideration the market factors, the purchasing power ability, the willingness to pay of the consumers of his market, but then he is the only one who decides the prices of the market. But here, there is no single seller. The number of sellers is so large that they are insignificant. They all are operating in the at par level. They all are operating in the same level. So here they are the price takers. But not only the sellers, but also the buyers. Both the buyers and sellers in perfect competition are the price takers. If you say they are the price takers, what do you mean? You mean that something else, someone else is determining your prices. If something else is determining your prices and all the firms in the market are adopting the same price, what is happening is you can say the prices are determined by the invisible hand, means the market forces of demand and supply. At whatever price the demand and supply curve of the market intersect, that price becomes your equilibrium price, which exists and which is adopted by all the firms, each and every firm and each and every buyer in the market. So this is your market demand and market supply. When these curves intersect, whatever price you get, this price is what taken or adopted by every firm, and that same price is acceptable to all the consumers purchasing from all the firms in the perfectly competitive market. Now, why are we studying this through a spectrum here? I mean vis-a-vis. It's because we now have to come towards another imperfect competition known as the monopolistic competition. When you say monopolistic, I'm giving you one example. When I'm telling you that we operate in a perfect competition, we are saying all the products are almost perfect substitutes of each other. While writing, we might write that they are a perfect substitutes of each other, but there are no such products available in the market where you can say they are the perfect substitutes of each other, because yes, it depends on the utility, the level of satisfaction, preference, taste, habit, all these things. But many of firms come very close to operating as a perfect competition. And in monopoly also, we cannot see a single firm which has such a control over the prices. But yes, pure monopoly you might not find, but then many of firms come close to being called as the monopolist. But then, for example, let me say I am talking about producers of a smartphone. What is happening? There are like multiple producers of a smartphone, but are those smartphones a homogeneous product? Absolutely not. So you cannot say that the market for smartphones is the perfectly competitive market. But if I say I am talking about a particular brand, let's say I am talking about iPhone. These are the smartphones. But what is happening is they have a consistency, they have their own brand image, they have their own operating system. All of these things means smartphones can be produced by another large number of buyers, but iPhone could be produced only by the Apple. So what is it? It does have a monopoly in itself. It has a monopolist behavior in the greater market of smartphones. So that is what we call as monopolistic competition. Means it has features both of monopoly and perfect competition. Some feature of monopoly and some features of perfect competition make another imperfect competition called as the monopolistic competition. Please pay attention here. When you talk about monopoly, you do not keep the word or associate the word of competition with it, because absolutely there is no competition for a monopolist when he is under monopoly, because he is a single seller. When you say perfect competition, you mean all the large number of sellers are in such a competition with each other that they cannot decide for prices, they cannot even influence the prices. So here, when you combine these two things, or when you talk about a market which has a, you know, behavior of a monopoly in to a certain extent, but then there are multiple players in the market, which is a feature of perfect competition. So when you combine sort of these two things, then what you come across is monopolistic competition, like a monopoly, but there is still a competition. So this type of market is the most practical market you can find out there. Like I told you, right now just I gave you the example of smartphones. There is a huge competition in smartphones, but there are some brands who have an upper edge. They act like a monopoly, like Apple. They act like a monopoly. But what is happening? New entrants in the market, like OnePlus, you can say, they are developing certain features which are similar to that, and then they are affordable as well. So they are giving a competition even if some brands have their own monopoly behavior. So this monopolistic competition has fairly large number of sellers and large number of buyers. When I say fairly large, I mean not as large as a perfect competition, but fairly large, little less than perfect competition. But still, when you take it as an explanation, you always understand that there are large number of buyers. Although we can, you know, count certain brands which are in the market for smartphones, but those are the brands that we know quite often, which are like famous, okay, which have their sales increasing day in and day out. But there are also some other brands which are in the business of making smartphones. So we say in monopolistic competition, or monopolistic competition is that firm or that market structure in which there are fairly large number of sellers and, as always, large number of buyers. Correct? So whenever you write these seller point of view for classifying the various markets, what you have to do is focus on the number of sellers. The number of buyers are always going to be huge. Whatever you bring to sell in the market, there will be buyers who will be ready to purchase it. Now, during this pandemic also, you think there is no purchasing power, there is no income, people are being laid off, and everything that is going bad with the economy, we are aware. But do you think there is like no sale in the market, or the sale is decreasing? Absolutely not. There is like this, it's such a hilarious situation that when you go in the market, there is so much crowd that you don't even feel we are in the midst of a pandemic. So that is what, in every particular type of competition, there will always be large number of buyers, but what classifies or categorizes them or distinguishes them from each other is the number of sellers. In monopoly, there is a mono seller, that is the single seller. In perfect competition, the number of sellers is so huge that none of them are significant or in a position to influence the market. But when you talk about monopolistic competition, you are talking not only about the number but also the behavior. So there will be fairly large number of sellers, but some of the behavior will be like a monopoly. Means, I'm trying to tell you is, here whatever products are produced are similar to each other. I cannot say identical, right? But they are kind of similar to each other, which can be used as a substitute for each other. So, we can say that under monopolistic competition, what happens is the products that are produced are although not perfect substitutes, but close substitutes of each other. The products that are produced in monopolistic competition are close substitutes of each other. They might not be the perfect substitutes, but they are very close substitutes of each other. Means, like we told, that in smartphone category or in the market of smartphones, there are smartphones which have similar features, and those are the close substitutes which you can prefer according to the prices or taste or preferences or at the given point of time your ability and willingness to pay. So first feature that we saw in case of monopolistic competition is that there are fairly large number of sellers, fairly large sellers. Second that we just saw is that the products are what? Close substitutes. Very close substitutes of each other. Then when I say close substitutes of each other, you tell me what is going to be the price elasticity here. Pause the video and think about it. If I said in monopoly, since there is only one seller, you cannot, you know, shift your demand. So either you have to accept the demand at whatever price it is, or you have to just go without the product. And without the product you cannot go, because there is no other seller, you have to have that product. Then your demand will be what? Less. Inelastic, I mean. And when there is absolutely huge array of things to choose from, when they are the perfect substitutes, you don't care about it because the prices won't change. They are adopted from the industry. So then your demand will fluctuate, and it will be easily shifted from one product to another, since there are very large number of sellers. So the demand is infinite, okay, perfectly elastic. But when I say monopolistic, I am telling you that there are multiple sellers who have close substitutes, but then with regard to your preferences, tastes, habits, or let's say your income capacity, what is going to happen is your even a slight change in price is going to fluctuate your demand by more. Means I can say that the elasticity is greater than one, because now you have greater substitutes available. The higher the substitutes, greater is the degree of elasticity. So since we said there are close substitutes and not perfect substitute, so we can't go to the extreme situation of, like, let's say infinite possibilities, infinite elasticity. We can say that the elasticity is greater than one. So what is so good, or what is so differentiating factor of monopolistic competition, is that here the products are differentiated. I am not saying they are homogeneous product. I am not saying there are products which are totally different from each other. I am not saying that the sellers have absolutely no control over prices, or they cannot charge different prices for their own product, which is ultimately not true. They cannot charge different prices for same products. But what is happening here is, I can say the most distinguishing feature is that of product differentiation. When I say here these are differentiated products, I mean heterogeneous, different types of products. But here when I say product differentiation, I mean each and every firm in monopolistic competition is trying to capture more and more market shares, right? In the electronics field, in the mobile field, we'll stick to the same example. What is happening is, day in and day out, everybody is producing some new model. Every day there is a new model coming in, and what, according to the market demand situation going on, they are working on their prices, they are working on the features, and especially they are working on the camera thing, which is, you know, making it more friendly for this entire vlog and this system of social media. So what is going on? They are trying to differentiate their product. They are trying to involve some of the feature which is, you know, completely new or which is more improved than some other product which is a close substitute. So every seller possibly is trying to maximize the features and minimize the cost, correct? They are trying to make it more endearing, more likable to the masses. So product differentiation means for this they have to incur something called as the selling cost. There is very high selling cost. Why is this selling cost required? The selling cost is required because you now need people to know that your product is different from some other competitor and how is it different. So you are going to want to advertise that thing more. You are going to want to, you know, pre-launch this product. You will want to take bookings for this product. Now on Amazon, we see that every product before coming into the market, they put up an ad coming soon. Why is this? Because they display all the features. They display the entire video of how the phone looks like, what are the features, what are the operating systems inculcated in that. But then they have to incur high selling costs because they want to make sure that their product is being advertised in a different manner. Then selling cost does not only involve the advertisement cost, it involves the publicity cost, the transportation cost, the extra things that you do for your product to become more likable, that is the packaging, the labeling, the outlook, all these things come under the selling cost. Selling cost means the cost that a producer incurs in order to make his product look different so that he will have a competitive advantage. So under monopolistic competition, the main aim again remains profit maximization only. Of course, in the further lectures, we are going to see how the curves act in monopolistic competition as well. What is the profit maximization point? But here also, in all three of these competitions, what is happening is the main aim remains profit maximization, but the behavior and the nature of these firms make it different approaches. Like we saw here, the demand curve is little steeper. Now when I say it is elasticity is greater than 1, here the demand curve will be flatter because a small change in price of product A will lead the consumers to shift to product B because the prices are rising and we don't want anything which is, you know, having higher prices and the same features as the another which becomes comparatively cheaper. So we will definitely go and purchase the comparatively cheaper product. So elasticity is greater than 1 means here the demand curve is what? Flatter. And again the extreme position, that is the perfect competition, where demand curve is horizontal, means it is a perfectly elastic demand. Horizontal means the demand curve is the marginal revenue curve and it is only the price line of the market. So far in monopolistic competition, these are the features that are involved, or these are the features that make it more practical, because when you go to the market or when you observe even the e-commerce market, you can see that amongst all the imperfect competition or the perfect competition that we have seen so far, the monopolistic competition is the only competition which fits best, right? Means there are multiple products of a similar nature. I can also give you one more example, the example of soft drinks. These are the products which are like very much close to being a perfect competition, but then they also, some products also constitute the monopolistic competition because some consumers are so loyal to it and then they are trying to, you know, put in the taste and everything. So the toothpaste industry is also very close to perfect competition because the formulation and all is the same thing. But once they try to change it to some flavors, involve everything, you know, like salt from clove oil and everything, which, you know, they try to make it little different, then the perfect competition turns into the monopolistic competition. That is why we say that the perfect competition is very idealistic situation. That is why we get a demand curve which is a horizontal. But in imperfect competition, these are not perfect competition. So we have to just focus on who is the seller, how many numbers of sellers, and how do these sellers behave in a typical market, and accordingly we can find if they have any influence over the prices or not. So here we absolutely did not talk about the prices. So do you think that in a monopolistic competition you are the price maker as a seller or you are the price taker as a seller? In monopolistic competition, although you can differentiate your product, you cannot make the market prices. You can definitely influence the prices of your own product, but you cannot differentiate the market prices. Everybody will try to influence their own product prices, and accordingly, if you have, say, let's say XYZ feature, then you are setting the prices at 21,000 rupees. And similarly, then looking at that, you are influencing some other producer also who has the XYZ features and plus some extra features, so he will demand more than 21,000. So you are not setting the prices in the market, but you are definitely influencing or you are definitely affecting the prices in the market. So that was all for our monopolistic competition. In the further sessions, we will see how the curves, the cost curves or the revenue curves of monopolistic competition affect the profit maximizing decision of a seller. Thank you.